Hi there, my name is Timothy Babatunde, and welcome to today's Devotionables, a brief devotion for busy people. Today, from Matthew 8, 5 to 13, I want to talk briefly about faith grounded in knowledge. When we're sick and we go to a doctor, we go with the expectation that we can be helped towards healing, right? However, one essential part of the process of visiting a doctor that we often don't think about is faith. It takes faith to visit a doctor. We believe that doctors can diagnose what's wrong with us and that they are trained and equipped to help the sick. So in the making the decision to walk into a dentist's office, for instance, after having a sleepless night of painful toothache, there lies a prior knowledge. The knowledge of who a dentist is and what a dentist is capable of doing by virtue of his professions. Based on this preconceived knowledge, I can confidently go to the dentist with full assurance that he can help me. So, in a sense, my faith in the ability of any dentist is essentially contingent on my prior knowledge of him or her as a qualified dentist. My point is this. As believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, our prior knowledge of who God is directly informs our actions in faith and trust in God. And then, in a sense, on this side of eternity, our daily walk by faith and complete trust in Christ is directly proportional to our knowledge of who Christ is. Our knowledge of God directly influences our faith and trust in who the Lord revealed himself to be and all that he is for us. This is one of the principles we see playing out in the centurion's encounter of Jesus Christ in Matthew 8. After the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew recorded that the centurion ran to Jesus in desperation for help on behalf of his servant who is painfully suffering from paralysis. Now, why will the centurion go to Jesus for help in the first place? Well, from the text, it is clear that it's because the centurion was confident in Jesus' power to heal his servant. And when we observe this text closely, we come to realize that the centurion's prior knowledge of who Christ is gave him the assurance that Christ can heal his servant. In verse 8, we see that Matthew portrayed the centurion as one who really know who Christ is and what Christ is capable of as the Lord and how unworthy he is of having the Lord of all coming into his home. So all he needed was for the omnipotent Christ to say the word and his servant will be healed. And what was Christ's response? Christ acknowledged his faith, and as the Lord of all, Jesus spoke the words of mercy. In verse 13, it said, "Go, let it be done for you as you have believed." Now, we don't know how long it took the centurion to come to know Christ's power, but we can surely deduce that arriving at such faith and belief in Christ's ability did not happen overnight. It takes knowledge that is acquired from beholding Christ, watching Christ, listening to Christ, deeply contemplating who Christ is for the centurion to act in faith and cast himself at Christ's merciful feet in time of desperate need. Beloved, on this side of eternity, we are called to live by faith and not by sight. Yet, our faith and trust in the Lord grows as we grow in our understanding and knowledge of this great God. Some time ago in college, a friend of mine, he asked me straight up, "What do you mean when you say I should trust in the Lord?" I thought about it and answer to this question, I don't really have. So I went to the Lord in prayer like, "Lord, what does it really mean to trust you?" But one night I was reading Proverbs 3:5-6, which says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and it will make your path straight." Immediately after reading that text, the question came to mind, can you trust someone you don't know? I reasoned for a bit and answered myself, absolutely not. Then I began to realize that the level at which I trust someone, if at all, is highly contingent on how much I know the person. Since then, I changed my prayer to Paul's plea with the Lord is that I may know you and the power of your resurrection in Philippians 3:10. Beloved, let us seek to know this God and believe who he says he is, so that our joy might be full in all that he has for us and all that he has done for us and all that he is for us, and be strengthened to endure times of affliction through this pilgrimage. By the help of the Holy Spirit within us, as we increase in our knowledge of God, so our faith and trust in who God is will necessarily increase. So I pray that the Lord help us grow in all spiritual knowledge and understanding today. Amen.